Who's choosing the shot?
Hold on. You're gonna need your shoes, right?
Oh my God, shoes. The Saul withdrawal is finally over. We have made it to the back half of season 6 of Better Call Saul. Hi, my name is Courtney. You are watching Courtney's Reviews. If you're a first-time viewer, please consider hitting that subscribe and that like button if you like what I'm doing here. And as always, feel free to share your thoughts in the comments below. All right, this is a big one. Let's get right into it. Join me for my breakdown of season 6, episode 8. Point and shoot. So in 450 BC, Aristotle was the first to theorize about the four elements: earth, air, fire, and water, the four elements thought to sustain all life. Now, where else have you heard elements in this universe? Chemistry. Breaking Bad is a show about a chemistry teacher who breaks bad, and an element in chemistry refers to the purest form of a substance containing only atoms and cannot be broken down further by any means. These elements are classified according to their chemical and physical properties and arranged according to their atomic number on the modern periodic table. In this episode, we see the four elements represented: earth, air, fire, and water. And in many ways, I would say that this episode is a return to the basic elements of this universe. So we have Vince Gilligan directing, and we get a lot of visual and some linguistic callbacks to Breaking Bad. And I would also describe this episode largely as a plot resolution episode. So we see this is the conclusion to the Lalo storyline, and we see Gus's plan get executed. So a sort of carryover from plan and execution in the previous episode, where we see Jimmy and Kim's scheme come to a conclusion and end with the Howard storyline. So at this point, we're almost caught up to the beginning events of Breaking Bad. We're still a few years ahead of the Breaking Bad timeline, but we're almost at the end of the Better Call Saul storyline. There's only one question left to answer before we can get into the Breaking Bad storyline, and that is what happens to Kim. There are two other burning questions I think the series must answer ultimately before it comes to its final conclusion, and that's what happens to Jimmy and Kim, right? So we might get that answer when they answer whatever happens to Kim. Maybe that also lets us know what happens to their relationship, or maybe we won't know. Maybe Kim's storyline will continue into the Breaking Bad timeline and beyond. We'll have to wait and see there. And also, of course, what is going to happen to Jean, right? So those are the three questions: what happens to Kim, what happens to Jimmy and Kim, assuming she survives, and we're not, you know, whatever happens to Kim in the Better Call Saul timeline doesn't let us know what happens with her and Jimmy. And finally, what happens to Jean? This episode begins with a sort of classic cold open that we see in Better Call Saul and Breaking Bad, where we're shown an object and we don't immediately know how to make sense of it. Of course, as the camera pulls back and we see the green Jaguar on the beach, we know that this is Howard's car. And when we see his wallet with the ring on top, you know, the discerning viewer is going to figure out what that's about and how this is a staged scene left to be found. But we don't at this point yet know what's going to happen with Howard's body. And of course, that's a question that isn't answered until the end of the episode. This reminded me a little bit of this Breaking Bad opening teaser, where we see the eyeball bobbing along in the pool and we don't immediately know what is going on, and we don't find out until much later in that season. Now, this isn't the first time that we get a close-up on Howard's shoes this season. You'll recall in episode 6, Axe and Grind, as Howard is getting ready for the day in his guest house, we get the shot of him shining his shoes using this red and blue
shoe buffer. Red and blue being the elemental colors of this world, red being the color of crime and the unlawful, and blue being the color of the lawful and the righteous. And it also speaks to the care that Howard put in his appearance and in his presentation. And to see this, the way this scene has been staged of his suicide, also reminded me of the old Western cowboy saying of, I want to die with my boots on, and that is to die heroically, right? So to die with your boots on means that you die with honor. And so in this stage scene of Howard's suicide, we see just his shoes bobbing along, and of course they're never going to retrieve his body. He's dying with dishonor, with shame. He is disgraced, and that is the fiction that will be told, right? So he blew the sandpiper settlements. He made an embarrassment of himself in front of his peers and colleagues. His marriage is in shambles. A friend believes him to be a drug addict. So he's dying with what appears to be such disgrace. And to see his shoes bobbing along in this way, of course, as the audience, we know that this is a fiction that's being told. Howard was an honorable man. One other thing I wanted to mention about this opening teaser is I was listening to the Insider podcast, and Vince Gilligan mentioned that they shot this in California on Leo Carrillo Beach. And fans of the Coen Brothers films, or anyone who has seen The Big Lebowski more than once, might recognize Leo Carrillo from a line that Walter says when they're spreading Donnie's ashes in the water.
And as a surfer, he explored the beaches of Southern California from La Jolla to Leo Carrillo and up to Pismo.
Donnie was an innocent bystander in that film, and Howard is an innocent bystander in Better Call Saul. So we got the first of our four elements in the cold open with water, and we get our second, fire, immediately after the title sequence with a close-up on the candle flame. This episode picks up where plan and execution left off. Fire burns, and we see destruction in the scene with what looks to be parts of brain matter on the coffee table where Howard hit his head, blood spatter on the wall and painting, and like the movement of the tide rushing in, Howard's blood pooling forward on the floor near the shell casing. Shot number one from Lalo's gun. Lalo quickly takes control of the situation. Now, in the previous episode, Kim and Jimmy were the ones in control as their plan played out exactly as intended, well, until Lalo showed up. And here we see them helpless and under the control of others. This is something that we will see throughout the rest of the episode. Lalo gets the two of them to sit down, and then he tells Jimmy what he wants him to do. He describes Gus, that he kind of looks like a librarian, and describes him as a house cat, and then he gives Jimmy directions on how to get to Gus's house. As we have seen in all of the other episodes so far this season, the episode titles have more than one possible meaning. For example, plan and execution, to execute a plan, and execute to kill, hit and run as in the vehicular crime, and perhaps hit as a slang word for sexual or narcotic, if you will, gratification, and then to run or flee, and we get multiple meanings of point and shoot in this one. Lalo tells Jimmy he wants him to take the gun from the glove box and point and shoot when Gus answers the door, and then to take a point and shoot camera and point and shoot after. Then, of course, point and shoot is what we later see Gus do in the lab, but more about that later. So as Lalo explains to Jimmy what he wants him to do, he tells him that he has an hour or, as in or else, when Jimmy interrupts him to insist that he send Kim because the house cat is more likely to open the door for a woman. Of course, we as the audience know Jimmy is just trying to get Kim out of the apartment safely. He just witnessed the psychopath shoot Howard in the head, and there's just no way he's going to leave his wife alone with him. And Kim starts protesting because she knows what Jimmy is doing. He wants her to escape, and the way I read the scene is that Jimmy just wants her to flee. He doesn't necessarily intend for her to actually follow through with this crazy plan, and I think Kim knows that Jimmy's willing to lay down his life for her just to get her out and into safe, you know, get out safely. And it is a really sad moment, and Bob Odenkirk remarked at the Tribeca screening that it's a romantic scene where they think it might be the last time they ever see each other. So why does Lalo agree to let Kim go? Was Jimmy's argument persuasive? Or could it be because Lalo knows that Kim will actually go through with it? Now, neither Kim nor Jimmy at this point know what Lalo's actual objective is. He's smart enough to know that Gus's house is heavily guarded, he has seen the guards at the laundry, he just needs one of them to go there as a diversion to raise the alarm, flush Gus out, and get his men to scatter to give Lalo opportunity to get into the laundry. And while Jimmy is perhaps hoping that Kim will run, Lalo's confident that she'll do it. In Backman, Kim did go down to see him in prison when Jimmy went missing. Lalo knows that Kim loves Jimmy and is willing to do risky, dangerous things for him.
So you're his wife and you love him, and he didn't come home last night, and you got scared enough to come down here and talk to me.
He knows she is ride or die. He's so impressed that he again remarks,
"How does a chichifo like you land a girl like that, huh?"
If there was any doubt that Kim loves Jimmy, I think this episode puts that to rest. She was willing to go through with this crazy plan to save Jimmy.
Before moving on, there is one other thing I wanted to discuss about this particular scene. As Kim is getting ready to leave, she is stopped by Lalo and reminded that she is going to need her shoes. Now, understandably, anyone in this position would be shaken up. They may not be thinking clearly, and that certainly seems to be the case with Kim. She's in a state of shock, right? She's not thinking about her shoes. Now, when I first saw this, this reminded me of a scene from Breaking Bad when Mike goes to Chow's warehouse and he shoots Chow, and then he's telling Chow to get his assistant to drive him to the hospital. And then as Chow's getting up to go, Mike reminds him that she's going to need her shoe to drive him. And people don't think clearly, right, when they're in a state of shock. Someone else, though, pointed out on Facebook that this might be a callback to season 5, episode 3, The Guy for This. Now, in that episode, Kim goes back to Mr. Acker's house at night with a couple of real estate options. She feels bad about ousting him, and she shares this story with him.
When I was little, my mother used to shake me awake in the middle of the night, yelling it was time to go. She was always one step ahead of the landlord. I'd throw my things in a cardboard box and run outside in my pajamas and bare feet. Sometimes it was so cold, my toes turned blue.
So if we think about little Kim, young Kim, having to run out in the middle of the night without shoes on and how confusing and frightening that must have been for her, it lends a sort of sadder context to this scene here. So the fact that Kim is carrying some extra trauma is poignant. And there's a scene later on the episode that also may perhaps call back to some of that early childhood baggage that Kim has.
After Kim leaves, Lalo ties Jimmy to a chair and shares that it was Nacho who set him up, and we get this line from Jimmy.
Ignacio? Nacho?
Whoa, 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 I barely know Ignacio. Whatever he did alone, not with me. Listen, you gotta believe me, hand to God, I had no part in this. It wasn't me, it was Ignacio!
Now, this is a callback to Breaking Bad Season 2, Episode 8, where we first meet Jimmy in the episode entitled Better Call Saul.
Oh, no, 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 no! No, it wasn't me, it was Ignacio! He's the one! Oh, no. Oh, no, 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 no! Ay, siempre soy amigo! Siempre, siempre
Shut
soy
up,
amigo
man.
Del cartel!
Shut up! I just speak English.
Lalo didn't send you? No, Lalo!
Who?
Oh, thank God! Oh, Christ.
So now we know the origin of that line. The story has come full circle. The writers have satisfied that question of who is Lalo, who is Ignacio, and they answer it here. So at the end of the scene in this episode, Lalo tells Jimmy that he's going to come back and he's going to get the whole story. Now, we know that Lalo won't be coming back, and Mike even tells Jimmy that Lalo will not be coming back, but Jimmy really has no reason to believe Mike since he was made the same promise before when he went to Mike out of, you know, concern that Lalo would be coming back and might harm Kim, and Mike assures him that Lalo will not be coming back because Lalo Salamanca was going to die that night. And of course, that was the night of the failed assassination in Something Unforgivable.
As Kim is driving to Gus's house, she comes to a stoplight and a crossroads, both a literal and perhaps a metaphorical one, as a police car pulls up next to her, giving her the opportunity to reach out and ask for help. Of course, we see that she doesn't do that, and she goes forward and she's going to go through with the plan. As she arrives at Gus's house, we get this shot of her that is very reminiscent to the scene of Walter White going to Gus's house in season 4 when he was going to kill him. And on the Insider podcast, Vince Gilligan talked about how they shot this scene up on a scissor crane at like 4:30 in the morning, and they tried to get it as close as possible to that scene from Breaking Bad. And then we also get the third element, air, as Kim is waiting at Gus's door. You see the wind blowing, and in literature, wind often sets the tone or the mood, and in this scene with the rising music, the rising tension, that is well established.
Stay calm. Now you take a deep breath, a deep breath.
Air, of course, is also symbolic for breath, and Mike instructs Kim to take a deep breath and to tell him what is going on. So she tells him what's happening with Lalo and that he's going to kill Jimmy, and Mike has her sit, and she gets pushed back into her seat when she tries to stand up. So just like how Jimmy is forced to sit in a chair in the apartment, Kim is forced to sit. And although she's not tied up, the sense of helplessness and lack of control is similar between them. And as we'll hear Kim say throughout the scene, tell me what's happening, tell me what's going on, she is terrified, right? She is scared out of her mind for Jimmy's safety because she thinks that Lalo's in the apartment and is going to kill him unless, you know, she's able to execute his plan. And of course, Jimmy is lying on the apartment floor, tied to this chair, scared out of his mind and concerned for his wife, because who knows what's going through his head? Maybe he thinks Lalo went after her, or who knows what? You know, it's a frightening situation for both of them. And they were in total control in the previous episode, and now they are rendered completely helpless in this episode. And in a way, it's something of a projection, I think, onto the audience, this lack of knowing what's going to happen to these characters, right? So at least it was for me. I felt a lot of anxiety watching it, of course, and I still feel a great deal of anxiety about what is going to befall Kim and what, of course, will happen to their relationship. So after Mike and some of the guys leave to go to the apartment, Gus is watching Kim on the camera, and he calls and asks to speak to her. And Kim relays that the original plan was actually that Jimmy was supposed to come, and he talked Lalo into letting Jimmy send Kim instead. And this surprises Gus.
Why did Lalo send you?
Who is this? He didn't want to send me, not at first. He wanted to send my husband, but my husband talked him out of it because he wanted to get me out of there.
He talked Lalo out of it.
That's right.
So you might think that Gus is impressed that Jimmy was able to persuade Lalo to do something, but it's actually an epiphany. So much like he heard Spice Girls and then was reminded of perhaps Madrigal in Germany, he has figured out that Lalo has a different plan here. And he, of course, has already figured out what Lalo really wants. Lalo wants to get into the lab. Lalo wants proof. And Gus has prepared for just such a contingency, right? So he decides to go to the lab. And you see him take off his tie. And it's the same tie with circles on it that we saw in a previous episode, in Plan and Execution, where we're told not to get lost in the circle of confusion. And it's also somewhat reminiscent to the episode in Breaking Bad, when right after Gail Bettaker is killed and Gus goes into the lab and he disrobes himself, he takes off his tie and he kills Victor. So something else that I found interesting in this scene was the decision to film Kim's reaction and her side of the conversation with Gus through the security camera. So she's distorted and pixelated. It's fuzzy and blurry. And she is reduced in this moment. But also it sort of reminds me of the opening title sequences that we see that looks like videotape that's been over-recorded many, many times. It's distorted and blurry. So Kim is distorted and blurry. So this could have a lot of different meanings. It could be just because she is reduced in this moment. She is powerless. Her identity and her future are somewhat unclear, and it's fuzzy to us as the audience. And we are seeing her through the screen as we are watching her on our screens at home, and it's distorted. And I think it's also distorted for Kim at this point. And when I say her identity is perhaps somewhat unclear, Lalo refers to her as Mrs. Goodman. Now, of course, he doesn't know her real name, and he refers to her as Mrs. Goodman back in Bagman. When he meets her for the first time, he knows she is Saul Goodman's wife, so Mrs. Goodman. But I think it also has a greater meaning than that. So I mentioned this in the podcast on Pete Pepper's channel when we were discussing this episode, that she has played a large part in crafting and creating the Saul Goodman character, but she has taken on several different identities over the course of the series, as have other characters like Jimmy McGill, AKA Saul Goodman. And Saul is in large part her creation. So seeing her slip and be Slippin' Kimmy or Giselle St. Clair or Victor with a K, right? There are these different identities that they are trying on. And it's unclear to us at this point who Kim Wexler is, and is she going to come out of this being the Kim Wexler we first met, this sort of upstanding, good citizen lawyer, or what? Like, is this going to stain her and tar her forever? Is there a chance for redemption, or is she going to fully assume the Mrs. Goodman persona going forward? It is a question that we are all asking. So after this discussion with Kim, Gus takes a few of his guys to the lab, and we see Mike arrive at the apartment. He takes the gag off Jimmy, and Jimmy is able to tell Mike that Lalo left shortly after Kim did. And then Mike obviously figures out where Lalo most likely went. So in the lab, Gus is looking around where he hears the whirring of the fan, and he looks up and he sees that the screen has been busted through. And again, we have the element of air. So the wind blowing in Kim's hair and that rising tension, the threat to Gus. And again, we have the movement of air. Things are being disturbed. Things are out of place. And it again is the threat to Gus. And Lalo appears and he unloads shots 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 into Gus's men, laying them all down. You'll recall that the first shot was Howard. So Lalo opens up his camcorder and he is again filming the story for Don Eladio, which of course Don Eladio will never see. But in order to make Gus compliant, Lalo shoots shot number 7 into Gus, who is wearing a bulletproof vest. And as Gus takes him down into the lab. Lalo is talking to Don Eladio, like, wow, look at this place, yada, yada, yada. And as they go down the stairs, Lalo kicks Gus to the ground, and he takes that opportunity to reload his gun, which I'm assuming is an 8-clip. So Gus gets back on his feet, and he tells Lalo that he can't kill him yet because he hasn't yet told Don Eladio what he really thinks of him. And Lalo looks at his watch, and he guesstimates that he's got about 13 minutes total until the cavalry arrives. And so he tells Gus that he's got 1 minute to tell his story. Now, I've seen some chatter that people think that this was unbelievable, and they were like, why would Lalo allow this to happen? And I have a couple of ideas here. And this was also something that they discussed on the Insider podcast. So Lalo is about to take out one of Don Eladio's top earners, right? So he's trying to gather proof for Don Eladio that Gus was going behind his back to try to go off on his own. And hearing what Gus really thinks of Don Eladio is probably going to soften somewhat the news that Gus is dead. And plus, it's also part of Lalo's hubris, I think. So I also mentioned this on the podcast I did with Pete Peppers, but I think each of these like characters in this world, in this universe, have an Achilles heel. With Walter White, it was ego, right? And wanting to be like the top dog. With Gus, it's this need for revenge, this thirst for revenge against the Salamancas that's ultimately his undoing. And with Lalo, it's this incredible hubris, this incredible sense of confidence and pride. And he wants to kill Gus, right? Like Gus tried to assassinate him. So he wants his revenge. He hates Gus, the Salamanca family. They all hate Gus. It's this, you know, war that's been going on between them. So, you know, he's delighted in telling this story to Don Eladio, and it thrills him to be able to record it. So while Lalo is distracted by Gus telling the story, and Gus starts pacing back and forth as he's, you know, spewing all this vitriol, he moves ever so closer to the extension cords, to the point where they're connected. And as I predicted, he cuts the power. I thought he might pull the power, but what they ended up doing was far better than what I imagined. Of course it is. And he stomps on the electric cord. And we had seen in a previous episode that he had counted his steps to the excavator where he hid his gun. And we are seeing the shot of the gun, just in case you didn't remember. I didn't think it was necessary for them to do that. Maybe for some viewers, it was a helpful reminder of what was to come. So Gus is able to, in the dark, make his way to the excavator. Lalo unloads his gun, and Gus grabs his gun, and then he points and shoots. And when he gets the lights on, we see that Gus, he did it. He took him out. And this shot of Lalo, you get to see his blue suede shoes really clearly in this shot. And when I first saw his shoes earlier in the episode, I was reminded of the Elvis song, Blue Suede Shoes. One for the money, two for the show, three to get ready. So now go, cat, go. And I was, again, making, you know, probably a tenuous connection, but this is just how my brain works. The fact that Lalo refers to Gus as a house cat, right? So the cat has won. And this cat and mouse game as well, like I mentioned this, I think, in my previous breakdown when Lalo is in the storm drain, that he's kind of rat-like, right? He's kind of like a rat. The cat is the victor. So the cat and mouse game has come to its conclusion, and the house cat got that rat. But Gus is wounded, so there's a little sangre por sangre here, right? So he did take a bullet through that grazed him. It looks like it was a clean entry and exits. And in one of the more lighter moments in this episode, he calls Lyle, and Lyle is singing a song to the La Cucaracha song that he's made up, Boyos Hermanos, Boyos Hermanos. And when we watched this at Tribeca, the audience burst out laughing. So it was great to see Lyle back. And it was a funny little ditty that he made up. And of course, it's a callback to the fact that in Bagman, again, Lalo tells Kim that Jimmy is like La Cucaracha, you know, he's a born survivor. And the reference here, framing Los Pollos Hermanos as La Cucaracha, you might also think of Gus as a born survivor. Of course, he, you know, it's not forever. He meets his end in Breaking Bad. But at least in this situation, he is the victor. He is the born survivor here. So before moving on, there were just a few other things I wanted to discuss about this scene. So when Lalo is leading Gus to the laundry machine before they actually descend into the lab, he is telling Don Eladio how he wishes that they didn't have to rush this. And he wishes that instead they could be sitting by the pool, you know, pulling Gus's skin off inch by inch like a snake. And the whole, I wish we didn't have to rush this, reminded me of, again, in Plan and Execution, when the camera guy is developing the replacement photos that they have taken of their fake Judge Casimiro. He tells Jimmy and Kim, you can't rush the process. You can't rush the process. And I think that is a theme that is starting to develop, that when the characters are impulsive or they're not taking their time, you know, they're not being as careful, and bad things happen when you're not as careful. And, you know, this is how Lalo meets his end. And I feel like I would be remiss if I didn't discuss this final shot of Lalo as he lays dying on the ground, and he has this rictal grin on his face and he laughs, you know, and it's a very appropriate send off for this character. So back at the apartment, Jimmy is sitting in the bathroom, and we see a long shot of Howard's body covered. And Mike and Kim come in, and Jimmy and Kim embrace, and it's this sort of heartbreaking, sad, and joyful moment for them. Not joyful, but, you know, relieved moment that they're both still alive. And Mike tells them that they're going to be getting a new refrigerator, and he hopes that stainless is okay. And I thought this was interesting, this use of the word stainless. Of course, stainless steel fridges are popular, and stainless steel in general is a popular choice for kitchen appliances. But this idea of being resistant to stains, I think, speaks to Mike's role as a cleaner. And that's what he does. He comes in and he cleans up the mess, and he's going to make this all go away. They pack Howard into the old refrigerator, which is then removed all neat and tidy. And he tells Jimmy and Kim what's going to happen. So as they're sitting on the bed, he explains what they're going to do and how they're going to go about their day. And that when Howard's car is found, then they're going to need to call the police. But I'm not so sure that this is a stain that's going to easily wash out. I don't know that they're going to be stain resistant or stainless themselves. And we know that Jimmy will continue on, of course, and he becomes Saul Goodman. So the question of how this is going to affect Kim, and also how it's going to affect Jimmy. I mean, is this the final push into fully becoming Saul Goodman? I mean, is this going to break Jimmy in such a way that he fractures and compartmentalizes? Yudi Reviews on her channel, when she was doing her review of this episode, made an excellent observation, and she mentioned this in the live stream that I also did with Pete Peppers. And I thought a lot about it after the stream ended. I just kept thinking about it. I was like, wow, that's such a great insight. And then I went and watched her video. And she talked about how the way that Kim is sitting on the bed is a callback to the flashback scene of Kim in Svensson's, the store where she tries to lift the earrings and necklace, and how she's sitting there with her feet planted firmly on the floor, and she's sort of looking ahead, eyes somewhat averted, very short one-word responses. And we see that again here in this scene with Mike, as Mike is talking to her and she's looking down. She was seeking the discipline that, or craving attention, discipline from her mother, And of course, she didn't get it then. She wasn't penalized then for stealing the earrings. And so maybe that's something that she's been searching for. And here she's being told what to do by Mike. Now, he's not passing judgment on them. He's not reprimanding them or scolding them or blaming them. And I actually think that it might be a problem for Kim that there are no consequences for this. Like, this is going to just go away. Like, they're just going to go about their day and their life like nothing ever happens. And it's a struggle, I think, that might also refer back to how Jesse felt in Breaking Bad. I think of the scene where he goes to his meeting and he tells the story about, you know, killing a dog, of course, a euphemism for when he killed Gale, and how like he's having a hard time coming to terms with the fact that nothing bad happens to him, even though he keeps doing horrible things. And I think that Kim might have a similar struggle going forward. And so when Mike tells them that they're going to need to go to the police, since they're the last known people to see Howard, his car was in the parking lot in front of the apartment, so someone may have noticed, I think that might be an interesting moment for Kim. So I'm not going to speculate in this video. I'm running long already. That will be a separate video. And then in the final scene of this episode, we get the fourth and final element, Earth. And we see Lalo and Howard laid to rest in the floor of the lab. And Peter Gould had teased that the ending of Better Call Saul would change the way that we think of Breaking Bad. And I think this certainly changes the way we think of Breaking Bad. And actually, since I got to see it a little bit early at the Tribeca screening, I was rewatching some of the Breaking Bad marathon last weekend before the premiere of this episode. And I kept thinking like, wow, you know, they're under the lab there. Now, I think there might be other things that happen before the season ends that changes the way we might think of Breaking Bad. So I still think there's a lot of story to tell. We have 5 episodes left and I am excited and eager to see where this goes. All right, so I think I'm going to end this here. So if you like this video, please give me a like. If you're not yet subscribed and you made it this far, you might as well subscribe. I'd love to hear from you guys. Tell me your thoughts. What do you think of this episode? And I'll catch you all in the next one. Bye.